Wrestling. I'm your host, Toy Ain't Nice. Got my co-host, Tim Sometimes Is Nice. Say hi, Tim.
Sometimes Is Nasty. Hi, Tim. I'm glad to be back. It's been a while.
I mean, you were back last week. Okay, but, Tim, but yeah.
More officially back today.
Yeah, you weren't really back last week. He was half back last week. Now he's officially all back, guys. Alright, well.
Anyway, Money in the Bank.
I wasn't WrestleMania. Money in the Bank result. It was a good show. It was a really good show.
There wasn't a single bad match on the card.
There was this one part of the show that I was like, oh, this is necessary, but other than that.
There was a couple. The Cena thing was. You know, it's John Cena, right?
Like, right.
It's like he's a bull no matter what he does. I'm sure had you been in the arena, it would have been more fascinating. I mean, if I remember back to Mania, being in the arena, I felt like the whole thing with Shane McMahon and The Miz and Snoop Dogg was. It wasn't as horrible as it was when I then thought about it later. It was fine. It's probably the same thing.
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
Well, let's get into these results, shall we?
Yep.
So we got the first match, which I'm surprised this was the first match, but it's the men's Money in the Bank ladder match. You had Butch, you had Damian Priest, you had Logan Paul, Shinsuke Nakamura, who else? Ricochet, that freak Logan Paul, LA Knight, and who am I missing?
Santos Escobar.
Oh, that guy. But yeah. The LWO guy. My thought was, when I figured out this was the first match, I was like, okay, Damien's gonna win, right?
Yeah. The second I saw it come out, I was like, Damien, wanted LA Knight to win this.
Oh, yeah, me too.
This is so classical WWE. Like, I know why they're doing it. I know exactly why they're doing it. And I appreciate it. But it was like, WWE, you did it. We know you can do it. You did it with Kofi back in 2019. When you have a chance to do something with someone who is so insanely over that he could be like a mega superstar for the rest of his career, take it!
Right?
No. On the other hand, let me just say, I am perfectly happy with Damian Priest.
Oh, yeah, I am fine with that.
I am like the hugest Priest fan, always have been since back in NXT. I am so happy about this.
Yeah, I mean, I even said that was like my second choice. It would have been Knight. Yeah. I would have Priest. That's fine, right? I would have liked to have Priest, and that's it. And I think I know why they did it and what the angle is gonna be. And I will talk about that later on in the when we get to that other match. But like, I am fine. I was just like, why didn't you just give it to LA Knight? Like you said, he's so over. He's so like right there. He's great for the picking. Why not just give it to him? But whatever. You know.
Like it just doesn't make any sense to me. I know why they're not doing it, and a Triple H even said it in one of those out of universe interviews he does do on occasion. Later, and it basically apparently came down to, if he gets the Money in the Bank suitcase, he's going to have to get a Money in the Bank, a world title match, and they have no intention of actually making him world champion. So in that case, giving him the suitcase would have been a waste of what else they could do with him, because they can do a lot of other good stuff with him.
Right.
I'm saying, why not give him a world title reign? Why not? Yeah, he's 40 years old, but I've never understood the idea that as soon as you hit 35, you can never be world champion again. I can't wonder if this is a Vince McMahon thing where he's too small or some shit like that.
I mean, Knight's not that small.
No, he isn't, but at the same time, it's like, I just don't understand why the idea of making LA Knight someone who is super good in the ring, great on the microphone, and incredibly over, by giving him a title match, even a winning title match, would be such a bad idea. He doesn't need to keep it for long. Reigns have held this title for 3 years now. Let's say he challenged Roman and took advantage of, like, I'm not saying that, but the point is, he could beat, or if you don't want to do Roman, then he could beat Seth at Extreme Rules or something.
I mean, technically, he can use that cash in for any belt. What I heard, United States, Intercontinental, any belt.
But even if a world championship, like, have him cash in on Seth. Have him take it off Seth and have him lose it again next month. It's fine. Like, that's okay.
That's what they kind of did with, that's what they kind of did with, you know, Nikki A.S.H. You know, she didn't have that freaking belt long before she lost it to...
We've seen this before. Fuck, even Dean Ambrose was basically a, placeholder champion. Which is insane as it is, but he was.
True.
So, like I said, it seems like we're talking more about a missed opportunity with LA Knight, which we are, but again, I am so happy that Damian Priest did it, also again because of the storyline that will clearly be coming.
Right.
And this was just a really good match. I mean, they picked really good people for the match this year. Sometimes there's been someone in there where you're like, in a ladder match?
I do like in the beginning of the match, everyone was surrounding Logan Paul and just beat the crap out of him.
I mean, anytime Logan Paul gets the crap beat out of him, I'm happy. I understand why the WWE wants to use him. Like, his fan base is spectacular. Even if it might be on the downslope, at least that's what I hear. I haven't checked social blade. But, I mean, his fan base is spectacular, but at the same time, I'm like, he's an asshole, WWE. Like, he's a real-life piece of shit. No. Just no.
I think we could put him on because he's popular.
I think they are looking at... The only thing I can imagine is that they're looking at those 30 million 12-year-olds.
Money's
to convince
money.
Their parents to buy pay-per-view.
Money's money.
Views. That's the only...
I do have a complaint.
Yes.
Okay, so my complaint is when superstars are about to, like... When, like, Priest was about to, like, slam Logan Paul into a ladder match and then Butch stopped him, I'm like, please don't stop him. Let him kick his ass. You want as much people to kick each other's ass as possible so you can get the ladder and get the briefcase. Stop it.
Yeah, that's actually one of the things we've talked about many times is good in-match storytelling, and that has always been bad in-match storytelling.
Yes.
Always. It's sort of the same thing where we joked a little while ago, not a little while ago, like a year ago maybe, or we had that situation where in a tornado or in a multi-team tag team match where the New Day tried to pin each other.
Yeah.
Why have we never done that before?
Which is brilliant.
This is why you have all of those matches as tornado matches, because the other thing just doesn't make logical sense. But yeah, it's exactly said. No, don't stop that. While they're busy, you try to go up the ladder. That's what you do.
Right? That's the whole idea. Fight!
Yeah. Again, Butch was actually good in this match.
I mean, they all were good.
Yeah. But that's what that is. Nakamura did the usual stuff. He did fine. Escobar is great. Ricochet
committed suicide and took Logan Paul with him through the table.
Yeah. I mean, I can't... Who was it?
It was...
10 years ago, there was a wrestler that was called the Human Highlight Reel. Who had that title? Who had that nickname?
I don't know.
I can't remember. I think it was back in the 90s. There was someone called the Human Highlight Reel. And these days, that's basically Ricochet. Like, he can... Some of the shit that man can do is rather amazing.
Right, well, let's move on to the next match.
The end, let me just say, the ending was actually pretty cool. like the broken arrow from the top of the ladder looked sick.
Yeah. Well, next match we got the women's tag team match. Shayna Baszler and Ronda Rousey defended their belts against Liv Morgan and Raquel Rodriguez. And before you even say anything, this match, shock! I was in shock.
Yeah. Me too.
Like, I did not see that coming. I felt like a damn truck running through my house. Like, where the hell did that come from? I was on the second floor.
Yes, I do wonder if this is one of the, like, it can be good. I'm sure it will be good. But it's,
well, I have,
like,
a, I have, I heard something.
Like,
I heard something. Need, but go ahead.
Oh please, no.
No,
please,
no, go ahead.
All I was saying is. We're talking about the end, by the way. Like, this is a result show. There's no real reason to hide it. At the end, Shayna turns on Ronda, gets her into Coquina clutch, and then just leaves her for I think
Liv.
I think it was Rodriguez to pin. Fuck, I can't even remember. That's embarrassing. They did like a tag team finisher.
Well, it was Rodriguez, and then she tagged in Liv, and Liv did Oblivion, and I think Liv...
Yeah, that's how it was. Ronda. That's how it was. And then Liv and
obviously won.
And Rodriguez won. Won. Which is, like I said, Raquel, I don't have a problem with that. We talked about that before. I didn't think they would do it. I just... That turn... Like, Shayna's turning on Ronda feels like... I'm sure it can be good. I'm sure it can be very good. But it sort of felt like a twist for the sake of a twist. It felt like we should do something. Why? Because...
Well, probably because from what I hear, Ronda Rousey's quitting WWE after SummerSlam. So, they probably just want to go to have a little...
If that's the case and she's on her way out, that would explain it.
Yeah.
Then they can have a fight at SummerSlam, Shayna can win.
Right.
Ronda is out and Shayna is suddenly, you know...
Shayna, I want
the top badass.
The top badass again. Or if she's going... If Shayna Baszler is... Because on... Seems like on Raw, she seems to be like a face.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, she could go after Rhea.
Yeah.
You know.
Absolutely be an option. That would absolutely be an option. Like I said, I would love to see see her as like the top badass again.
Yeah.
Now we know that, like, my biggest problem with Shayna back in the day when she first came up and even back down in NXT was that she didn't really know how to sell, or at least she looked like she didn't know how to sell. And then she spent all that time basically, well, you know, selling for everyone really. Dropping matches left and right. So now we know she can do that. I wouldn't mind at all seeing her back on top.
And I think a good feud between these Ronda and Shayna will be great. And
yeah,
you know, because they both know each other. They know each other very well, and they're moved very well,
exactly.
And everything like that. So I have no problem. If this is how Ronda Rousey wants to go out, fine. That's cool. You know what I'm saying?
Perfect.
If it's true, but like
I mean, as far as I know, they're pretty good friends. It would make sense. Like, we've seen that before. Someone going out, putting over one of their friends.
Yeah,
wouldn't be the first time.
Yeah. Like, basically, the whole point was like, oh, you know, the reason why Ronda was even in WWE is because of Shayna, which is kind of true. So
yeah,
they just work in that angle and stuff like that, and
that,
everything else. I have no problem with it.
That would explain it a lot better than anything else I came up with, at least. Nonetheless, it was a good match. It was a good tag team match between those two. They really worked the usual style of Morgan being... Morgan being completely smashed, and then Raquel came in as the power wrestler and, like, turned the tides. It worked really well.
Yes.
And it was a good match. Like, it wasn't a 5 out of 5, but it was an enjoyable match.
It was enjoyable,
and,
yeah.
You know,
and it was a good
we have new tag team champions, and I'm sure the crowd loved that. I mean, I'm happy about it. They never lost the titles, and they basically only had to give them up because Liv got injured. I'm happy to see them back. Like I said, I want Raquel to become something big, because I think she has the potential. She just hasn't that it factor, but the best way to get that is to try, if nothing else.
Alright, well, that's that. You ready to go to the next match?
Yep.
We got the Intercontinental Championship match. Gunther defends his belt against Matt Riddle with that weird hairdo.
Yeah, Riddle with not with in, without hippie hair.
Is it braided up? This looks, I don't
really
know.
Weird.
Yes.
Like, not bad.
Like, I was just like,
weird.
I looked and I'm like, who's this guy in the ring? Where's Matt?
Yeah. What has he done with Matt Riddle? Yeah, it was like, what the hell? Anyway, another good match. Again, I don't think I can remember the last time Gunther had a bad match, and Riddle is very good at having good matches with people. A very good match. Good in-game storytelling.
Yeah.
They did what they should do, in my opinion, like with the injury thing and so on. Is Gunther, at this point, the best big man that we have on the roster? Like, just from a pure in-ring perspective?
I mean, he's one of the tops, I would say, yeah.
Yeah? Like I said, I really want...
I don't know if he's the best.
I really want Gunther to get, like, a world championship run. I really want him to get a world championship run.
I mean, I'm pretty sure it's coming.
I'm sure it will come. Like I said, it would make perfect sense. After the match, of course, Gunther won. Riddle injured his foot in the beginning of the match, and at the end, Gunther, you know, put him in a leg lock, so Riddle had to submit. We've seen that before. It's always good storytelling, and it's always fun. But Drew McIntyre came back.
Right, so we haven't seen Drew McIntyre since WrestleMania.
Yeah, no, we haven't. And even before that, he hadn't been around for quite a while, actually.
Yeah, with WrestleMania was the last time I saw him, but I remember seeing him.
Yeah. No, he hasn't been back since WrestleMania. And like I said, even before that, we only saw him, like, sporadically since, well, Rumble, I suppose. I'm very glad to see Drew back. I missed him. Again, that would be a great situation. You know, obviously they are going to have a feud now, Drew and Gunther, and it would make perfect sense for McIntyre to take the title, and then Gunther to move up to, you know, challenging
Roman. I'm not Roman or
Rollins or Roman or Jay or whoever has the title. I have thoughts on that regarding the Bloodline match later. But yeah, no, again, just a really good match. I can't remember the last time I saw Gunther have a bad match, or even just an average match. They're just all really, really good.
Yeah, it was good to see Drew again.
Yeah.
I liked it.
Drew was fine.
Yeah. Well, ready next match?
Yep.
So I got the next match. We got Dominic Mysterio with Rhea versus Cody Rhodes, which was a really fun match.
More to say about what happened on Raw than I have to say about this match, because like you said, this was just a super fun match.
Right.
Like, we said that Dominic has... back in the day, we always said that Dominic, like, needed to break out from his father and actually get good in the ring. Dominic has gotten good in the ring. And his personality, his character is just spot on, especially working with Rhea. And, I mean, this was just a really good match. We predicted it would be a very good match, and it ended up being that.
It was
funny. The 619 into an Alabama slam was actually a pretty cool spot.
Yeah. I liked it. There was this one part
I don't have many notes from. I don't have many notes from this show, so I didn't write down a lot of the spots, so I can't remember most of them. But I remember the 619 into a slam.
I remember Cody Rhodes had Dominic on his shoulder, and he kept spinning and spinning. I just kept thinking, Wonder Woman.
halfway through the match, the light goes out, and when we come back,
Right?
When we come back, Dominic Mysterio has transformed into into Rhea Ripley. Yeah, that would be the day.
That'd be great. It was just a good, like, good, silly, fun match.
It was just a very good and fun match. This is a good mid-card match.
Yes.
Like, it keeps both of them on an upward trajectory. Even though Dominic won, this is a match he can put back at and say, see what I can do. Give me something more. And I mean, Cody maintained. Again, I have more to say about what happened on Raw, because I have said it before, I will say it again. Why is Cody Rhodes feuding with fucking Brock Lesnar?
No.
Why?
I don't know. Because WWE wants him that way, that's why. Who knows? No idea. But, you know. Cody won up in the match.
That has nothing to do with the main show, of course.
I mean, if you were talking, you did. I did not hear one word you said.
I just said. Well, I mean, you can hear it later, I'm sure, in the when going through. I just said that I don't understand what they are doing, why they are having Cody Rhodes have a feud with Brock Lesnar. I don't understand it because it does nothing for Cody, and honestly, it does nothing for Brock either.
Yeah, it's a waste, but
very weird to me.
I don't know. Who knows? I know that Cody wanted to fight Brock, that's all I know, and Brock didn't answer him until, like, the other night on Monday Night Raw. I have no idea, I'm sure. I don't know. But
I'm sure. Like I said, it just doesn't make any sense to me what they're doing with him. It just doesn't. But there we are. Oh. Such is life in the zone.
Alright, okay, then, well, are you ready to move on?
Yeah.
Okay, well, there. Money in the Bank ladder match. We had Bayley, Io Sky, Zelina Vega, Zoe Starks, Trish Stratus, and of course, Becky Lynch. Which.
Last week we discussed that this match could really only have like one or two winners, and it would be used primarily to give one of them the win, and then continue or set up feuds between the others. And very rarely have we been more correct.
Yeah,
like it was still a super good match, but that was literally what happened.
Yep.
Again,
you had
Becky Lynch fought with Trish Stratus. Like, everyone tried to win it, of course, but Becky Lynch furthered her match with furthered her feud with Stratus, and at least partially Zoe Stark. Like,
there was one part where Zoe Stark tried to handcuff Becky Lynch to the ring, but Becky Lynch got out of it. You know.
Yeah, the ending was super fun. I was about to say the best part of this match was almost how Io Sky won, as I would like to point out, I predicted. I think Toya predicted it too, either her or Selena. But the ending was almost the best part, because, again, it was just super, like, creative. I don't think we've ever seen anything like this before.
Okay, well, tell them.
Again, like Toya said, Zoe Stark had tried to handcuff Becky to the ring rope. Becky got out of it, but she still had the handcuffs on one hand. So at one point, she started to climb the ladder, and Bayley was over there, and they were fighting. And then the other handcuff on Bayley's hand.
Yeah.
Inside the ladder.
Yeah, because they were fighting within the ladder. They were fighting inside the ladder slack. They were like trying to pull each other and stuff like that.
Yeah, like punching each other. They were like on the second or third like step, and was punching each other through the ladder, so to speak. And then Io Sky comes up and handcuffs them together inside the ladder, climbs it, and gets the title, which was perfectly fine. I was super happy about that. It was a really good, again, just a really fun match that did everything it was set up to do, or really did set up everything it was supposed to do, in my opinion. Like I said, the only thing is we don't really know what they're doing with Selena, but there we are.
No, I did. Wasn't Selena the one that was in the in the ladder and she was like, getting pulled by people. I don't know who she was getting pulled by. She was getting she was getting like tug of war into in the like this back and forth. I was like, ow, ow. I can't remember who it was, but I know who was in it, but I don't know who was pulling. Maybe it was like damage control or something like that. I'm not even sure, but it was like, out.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was, but I just think it was the damage control girls. I just think it was Bailey and Io together.
I mean, basically, it was like for the most part, Trish and Becky and Zoe were fighting each other like we said they were going to do.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean,
they were fighting each other more than they were trying to win.
Right,
which
exactly.
is exactly how it should be.
Right.
That was exactly how it should have been.
Right, and then I think at one point, Bailey pushed Io Sky off the ladder while she's about to go get the briefcase, and she dropped the ladder over, and that's why I was like, okay, that's why Io was like, all right, you want to play that game? I'm gonna handcuff you to Becky, and then climbs over her to get the briefcase.
Glorious! It was so good. Also, I love the picture. Have you seen that picture of probably Bailey breaking character? Now it might be in storyline, but I think it's Bailey breaking character, where like Io has the suitcase on top of the ladder, and Becky Lynch looks, you know, oh God, I lost, I need to cry, and Bailey is just a huge smile on her face. That seems more like, oh fuck, I got on camera, you know, being happy for my friend more than anything.
Well, I mean, it seems like they're in good spirits, because at the press conference, she did go out with Io Sky with her. Yeah, so, I mean, I don't think they, like, broke up yet, so.
Nothing.
I mean, I think if they, like, you remember that match with, I can't remember what pay-per-view it was. It was John Cena versus Shawn Michaels versus Triple H, and Shawn Michaels, like, super kicks Triple H. And then, it's kind of like that, I think. And it's like the next day, he's like, you super kicked me. He's like, it was for the belt.
Triple H was more or less like, yeah, all right.
Okay. That's cool. I would have done the same thing. I feel like that was that. Even though I do think that damage control should probably just break up, because
I mean, again, the point is, like we said, I don't think it has a point anymore.
Right, it doesn't.
Like, maybe it's just because I'm that Bailey fanboy, but it's clearly made a star out of Io Sky. I mean, it has showed people what she can do. Dakota Kai seems to have disappeared into the ether somewhere. And again, if they want to do something with Bailey, I don't know if it's time to turn her face again, but they have to do something else with her, because again, at least let her win a couple of bloody matches, for God's sake.
Something.
Or turn on Io Sky, or something, like just anything. Right now it's really not doing any of them any good, and clearly, at this point, they don't need it. But again, it was a really good match. It was a really fun match. Everyone did really well.
All right. Well, we got the World Heavyweight Championship match of the freaking Rollins defended his belt against Finn Balor, which was so good. Probably one of my favorite matches.
If it wasn't this was match of the night on a pure technical level. I think this was the best wrestling match.
It wasn't the best
match of the evening.
No.
But, like, from a pure, like, wrestling perspective,
I think this was the best match of tech match.
Clearly the best
match. I think the last best match was, like, an emotional match, but that's just me.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like, the last one was just the better, like, sports entertainment match. This was just the better wrestling match. As you know, expected. Freaking Rollins and Finn Balor, they are very, very good at what they do, actually. Rollins retained. Actually, the most interesting thing in this, of course, is not so much the match itself, but the fact that once we knew that Priest was going to win it, what was going to happen afterwards. Mm-hmm. And
during the match, Damian Priest came out while they were fighting and stuff like that. What were you going to say?
No, I'm just saying I'm here for what they're doing. I think it's very intriguing so far. Because, yeah, Damian Priest came out, distracted Baylor just as he was set for a coup de grace, and Rollins went into a stump and got the title. And then Baylor and Priest fought and argued. And then they did the same thing on Raw.
Yeah, and it's so kind of like...
They are building up that thing.
They're building up something, either between those two, and I don't know if it's going to, like, have Finn Balor cost a cash-in for Priest or not, and they have a feud or something, or whatever.
So
I don't
know.
What I
would do...
I wouldn't do that, but, you know...
No, what I would do was to have the breakup before Priest cashes in the suitcase. What I would do was have, so here's what I would do, and again, ignore, they're not going to do that, but what I would do was to have not a breakup of Judgment Day, because I think they're finally getting to a point where Judgment Day is very relevant. Finally, again. I would have the feud between Finn and Baylor with Baylor actually winning, but Priest getting just being kicked out of it, but he still has the suitcase, so he can then go face and then cash in on a Gunther World Championship. That's what I want to see. Then Finn, Dominic, and Rhea can hire someone else in to the Judgment Day that they feel like could use a push. That's how I want. That's how I would have done it.
There isn't. Yeah. I mean, I don't really
that's
deep into it.
That's probably not how they're going to do it.
I didn't thought that deep into it, but, you know, that seems like an idea.
No.
Yeah.
But again, the thing is, the Judgment Day inevitable civil war seems very... Well, I mean, it doesn't have to be a civil war. The Four Horsemen use that kind of thing very often to mess with Sting, like 8 or 9 times in 3 years. You would think Sting would have wisened up.
I mean, this
eventually
could all be just a
but
freaking...
He never did.
Yeah, it could all just be a ploy just to get freaking Seth Rollins.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Like
who
I
knows?
Said, Sting was the greatest wrestler of his time in WCW. He was also very, very dumb. back in
dumb
those days. So, like I said, it could theoretically be like a swerve thing, but we'll see. It's very fascinating what's going on right now, at least.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Alright, well, we got the last match. The Civil War bloodline match between the Usos and Roman Reigns and Solo Sikoa, which was an amazing match.
We said that, again, we have the Usos, who is maybe the best tag team currently working in the company. If not the best tag team, then definitely a shared number one. I still think it's really only the New Day at their peak and Street Profits that can match them. And, of course, Solo and Roman, and with all the emotions behind it, and just them knowing each other so well. I mean, as far as I know, Roman and Usos grew up together.
Yeah.
So they would probably have been working together since they first started. So, I can't really say anything.
There was this one part where, like, Roman was, like, I don't know, because his audience was so loud, and they were just so active, and they were, like, saying something about Roman, right? And Roman's like, why do we even come here? I hate these people. They're a bunch of idiots.
Good. The frog splash into a guillotine was pretty cool. Like, not a super hot spot, but it was pretty cool.
I mean, there were some cool moments. There was, like...
Yeah.
At first I thought, man, is this gonna be a match where the referee don't get injured? Nope, that didn't happen. But,
never.
But look, here's the thing, here's the thing. They didn't do any, like, cheat or anything like that. When the ref was not that long. It was like maybe 5 minutes, less than 5 minutes, the ref was out. And it wasn't like, you know, that I got the chair or got belts or got something to beat the crap out of the Usos with. No, they just did
Or a run-in or anything.
It was
very
just
weird.
It was just like a basically just beat them up, you know, and everything else. They spiked, Solo spiked Jimmy, and then they did a a solo spear spontaneous spike on Ray, and I was on Jay, and I'm just like, wow, okay, I'm like kind of surprised, right? And then I was like, oh man, they're gonna beat him, like they're gonna make this into SummerSlam, okay, damn it, like damn it. And then I was like, and then I was like, oh, he's putting Jimmy on top of Jay, and I'm like, oh, he goes pin him at the same time. I'm like, nah, they're gonna kick out.
Again, in the end, the Usos won. Jay got the pin.
Like I said, he should.
Yeah. I agree with you. I really agree with you. Like I said, either the Usos win or we need shenanigans.
Right. I mean, it's not even, it wasn't even like last week. I have been saying this like forever that Jay had to be the one to pin Roman. This is
where you and I have disagreed. Not in this case. Jay absolutely had to be the one to pick up the pin over Reigns in this match. Like, no question. What I have been saying is that I feel like it cheapens the rest of the roster significantly if another member of the Bloodline is the one to pin Reigns first. I think Reigns should have lost first, and then the Civil War kicked off on that basis.
Well, I think you're wrong.
I said that, I stick to that, but in the circumstance that it didn't, clearly Jay has to be the one to do it. Obviously.
Alright, well. Anyways.
And just a spectacularly fun match. Like a really, really fun match.
Alright, well, I have to go get my child.
First pinfall. First time Reigns got pins for 3.5 years. That's Hulk Hogan territory, guys. And he's a heel. That has always been the problem with him, by the way.
Alright. I'm gonna have to end it, guys. I have to go get my kid.
Yeah.
So, anyways.
Overall, super good show. 9 out of 10.
Yep, same.
9.5 out of 10. Same. Absolutely perfect.
Alright, well, I have to go get my child now. And I'll see you guys later. Bye.
Bye.